The world itself of Assassin's Creed is immensely... The depth of that world in itself is insane because, first of all, they can go to any single period that they want. So the sort of fan that you get with Assassin's Creed is a very detailed, orientated fan, and they go into the game and the way they play the game. It means that it's totally immersive. I also think that Ubisoft and Assassin's Creed do a really, really good job of catering to their fans. And I think they've done that since the first one, just in terms of the memorabilia. I mean, even at this Comic-Con today, the sort of stuff that they bring up to try, you know, ask you to sign is insane. And it's so beautifully packaged, the artwork. The world is just incredibly detailed. And I think that's what a lot of gamers like, you know, it's in terms of the graphics, in terms of the world, the levels, the sequences, and they just put a lot of time and effort into it, and they've done that since the first one. And not everyone's super successful, there's glitches along the way, but I think they just do a really good job. I'd never done a game before, so it was a new experience for me. I'd really wanted to do a game. I sort of pursued that job somewhat. I didn't realize how immersive that experience was going to be. What did we do? So I kind of started on it in the November because we had to do some stuff for the animation crew. So we just did like 2-3 days of just mocapping so that they could try and work out the animation of the characters. And then we started in January. We did a week where we literally worked with the script, and we did a day of just trying to explore the physicality of the assassins. Literally, honestly, just walking around the room, trying to imagine how these characters just would be and how they walk and how they embody the sort of the eagle vision and what that would do to the physicality, because it's highly important when you're mocapping. It's first and foremost what you do, and the fact that they were twins. So it was like trying to get this twin physicality between the two of them. And, you know, Victoria and I had to spend a lot of time together. Like, we spent quite a bit of time in the room together. Not tons of scenes, but the scenes when they were there, you had to like have this twin relationship. And I think if the relationship hadn't been there and it hadn't been so real, that game wouldn't have worked. You know, it's solely dependent on those two, of you selling in a video game this sibling kind of rivalry set of twins. And it took a lot of time. So, you know, we did a lot of dinners together. I did a lot of taking the piss out of Victoria, and she did the same with me. As you can tell from the Assassin's Creed San Diego story, she's highly competitive, and so am I, which helped for the two characters. And then we mocapped it for 4 months, 6 days a week. Pretty much straight through. I think we had 1 week off where I did a couple of cons. But, you know, and then we did 3 months in the booth, on and off. And then the DLCs we did in September, October, and then we did another one in November. And then we did promoing throughout the whole gig. So, it was a good year of my life. I didn't think it was going to be that long. But video games are like trying to build aircrafts while flying in the air. You know, it's a really difficult thing to do, and I was amazed. And I have a lot of respect for the people that work in that industry now, particularly the writers of the games, because you can write an arc of like a series, but to try and fit in gameplay and understand how leveling works, and then to try and develop an arc of characters that actually makes sense within that sandbox world, and, you know, because you can be anywhere at any one time, but you still write a cohesive story arc. I had a lot of respect. So Jeffrey, who had done some of the earlier Assassins, and I felt that we really went back to some of the early feeling that was in the Ezio trilogy. That was kind of my experience. It was awesome. I started off because I had a Spectrum 48K, then a Commodore, then an Amiga, then Sega, then Mega Drive. Then, you know, I had PlayStation 1, 2, 3, and then I had a child. And so my missus kicked the PlayStation 3 out of the house. So I had to stop on 3. And then I got it back last year because I could buy a PS4 for tax purposes. And how many people can say that? Hey, yeah, you, probably all of you. There's nothing like writing off a PS4 on your sheet, is there? Exactly. You just did it this year. It's lovely. It's nothing like, there you go, tax man. I was aware of like where the franchise was at. Certainly, you know, I think it felt like a reboot for the franchise. I think if we got this one wrong, it probably, you know, I don't know, but I have doubt whether they would have done another one. So yeah, we really reinvigorated the franchise. And yeah, as soon as I read the characters and the idea of having a playable female assassin in the main game was really exciting. And I felt that was going to be really exciting for gamers and for women who are a huge percentage of gamers, and particularly Assassin's Creed. So I felt we were in a good spot if we could get it right. And you know, with the Ezio trilogy, the games were, well, they were shorter back then because there was, I guess, less memory and, you know, less capacity. But they did have the trilogy to explore that whole backstory, which is, and the depth of which, you know, referring to the first questions that we had, that's what the gamers like. And we worked pretty hard to try and get a backstory that, you know, worked, that had, like, you know, a little bit of depth. Even though, like, on the surface level, Jacob seems like a bit of your classic archetypal assassin, kind of a bolshy, taking a piss and all that kind of stuff. You know, actually, I was trying to layer other levels of, you know, there's a reason why he's like that, you know. So he didn't have a mother. He didn't get along with his father. And then when you go through the game, so Pearl Attaway in that sequence is kind of like a mother figure for him. And then she betrays him. And then that sends him on a spiral, which then leads him to Maxwell Roth, who becomes like a terrible father figure. But, you know, there are layers there that we were trying to explore. And I think the game has really enjoyed that. And I think that's what you need when you play a video game. It's like, you know, the leveling is cool and all that, but you kind of got to care about the characters. Like, I thought that's what Last of Us got really right. And I was talking to Troy last week, and he did such a good job. They did such a good job on that game because you had such an emotional investment that, you know, for me, that was one of the, you know, by far the best games of that particular year, and probably one of the best games ever for exploring relationships and as close as games could get to films. And I felt that we kind of did that a little bit too. We were exploring things like comedy as well in mocap, which a lot of games don't do because it's hard to pick up on the nuances and the subtlety when you're mocapping and facial capture, and the animators don't really get it, and it's down to timing and things like that. But they now we're so close that we're able to do that. And that was a huge part of these characters. I think if it wasn't funny, it wouldn't have worked as well. You needed that levity within the sequences. I think that's what gamers really responded to. You know, they've got pretty progressive PR teams that, you know, the guys Stone and the crew in San Francisco do incredible stuff, but they do that for every single game. And with ours in particular, I mean, we had a fun one when we were at San Diego Comic-Con. They set up the American Ninja course. Which, you know, was incredible. Like, you know, you're at San Diego Comic-Con, you're on the Strip, which is like prize location, and opposite Hall H, they erected, I think it cost them $750,000 for 4 days, and they erected that ninja course. And I don't know whether you know the story, but yes. When we were at Comic-Con, Victoria, who plays Evie in the game, she called me out to race and challenge her on the American Ninja course. So I got up early in the morning, the next morning. You know, I can't let Victoria beat me. So I got up early, and we were both there, and, you know, the press, the crowd was starting to, you know, build. And then all of a sudden somebody was like, you're up. And I was like, oh my word, I guess I'm going. Now the first bit of it was like this steep incline wall. I thought, if I get past that first one, I'll be all right. So they said, 3, 2, 1, go. I run at that thing so hard, and I pull a hamstring straight off the bat. So then I run through the course, I get through it, and I get to the end, bang down on the timer. I was like, I did it. And they were like, hey man, what's going on? What are you doing? And I was like, it was my time, yeah? And they were like, no, man, we're going to do it now. And I was like, what? I was like, you don't understand. I've pulled my hamstring. I've just done it. I was like, Victoria, listen, I need 5 minutes to gather myself. And she's like, I'm not doing it first. So I was like, oh, right, I'm literally going again. So I had to do it straight away in front. And they were like, and here we have Paul Amos. And I had to run through that course. And I ran through it with a gammy leg. And I set the course record for the weekend. I don't know how I did it. It must have been adrenaline. Or, you know, I am a true assassin, perhaps. Who knows? So, yes, going back, they do think out of the box in, you know, the way that they market and the way that they... But, you know, it's a huge company. It's like a 4 billion corporation. They should be thinking outside the box. And they're in the world where you have to think outside the box. I think, you know, it's create or disintegrate, basically, in the gaming world. And as soon as you fall behind pretty quickly, you know... So, yeah. In terms of the game, the video, it's a really separate entity. And we've not really had a lot to do it with that. I don't know whether they're bringing any of the characters into the world. Maybe they will. Possibly. I don't know. I'd probably get shot and fired if I say anything because NDAs and yeah, I shouldn't really say anything about what's going to come out, but I think the trailer looks phenomenal, and I know FAS has put a lot of time and effort into it, and they've worked super closely with Ubisoft and the game developers. So I imagine that the world of the movie is going to be equally as rich and detailed as the games are, from what I've heard. Yeah, I didn't explore all of the games. Like I played a little bit of Black Flag, but I just tried to do my own thing, really. And we worked so long on the game, like a year full year. Like it's easy to talk about it after a while, and you know we spent a lot of time in that world. And coming out of it now, it's just nice to meet the fans. And it takes a little bit of it's a bit of a delay. It's funny because the game comes out and people do complete it, but people don't really get invested in the world until about 6-7 months after. So we're just now trying to explore that, because we're just making, coming out to Comic Cons and meeting the fans. And, it's really nice to get that response and see where the fans are at with it. And it seems to be really great. We usually ask, and people seem to think Syndicate was in like the top three at least. And, Jacob and Evie are up there, probably top two. So, yeah, it's been great.